So welcome to this webinar on benzodiazepines and prescription stimulants. This webinar is part of a series of tools called What You Need to Know About, which was developed in collaboration with the Centre Hospitalier Universitaire de Montréal, the CHUM. These tools address the use of opioids, benzodiazepines, prescription stimulants, opioid agonist therapy, and methamphetamines. Today's presentation is in English only, without simultaneous interpretation. This same presentation was offered in French last Tuesday and was recorded, so the recording will be available on our website in the coming weeks. The presentation is in webinar mode, so participants do not have access to their microphone or camera. Participants may ask questions in writing at any time during the webinar in the Q&A section. There will be time for questions at two moments during the webinar where participants can ask questions in the Q&A or verbally by raising their hand, and we will activate your microphone. This webinar will be recorded and posted on the Commission's website in the coming weeks. The verbal interventions from participants will be cut out from the editing, and the PowerPoint will be available upon request after the webinar. If you have technical issues during the webinar, please see the contact information in the chat from Alex, which is our support tech support, and she will be able to help you out if you need. So without any further ado, I introduce to you Dr. Stéphanie Marsan and Barbara Kotsaros and Joanna Cesar, nurses, and three of them are from the Addiction Medicine Services at the CHUM. So I pass it on to you, Dr. Marsan.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this next installment of the webinar series. So as Geneviève mentioned, we're going to talk to you today about benzodiazepines and prescription stimulants. And just before we get started, I just wanted to let you know about our conflicts of interest. I have been on some advisory committees for the pharmaceutical companies FVN and Indivior in the past. My colleague Barbara Kotsaros has also been on some committees for IV and Gilead. And my colleague Joanna Saint-Saëns does not have any potential conflicts of interest. So let's get started. So in terms of the objectives for today, what we're hoping to that you get out of the presentation is that to understand the reasons why people misuse benzodiazepines and stimulants. We also hope that you'll be able to recognize the signs and symptoms of benzos and stimulant intoxication and withdrawal, that you'll also understand the consequences of using these substances on a more regular or chronic basis, and to also be aware of the different treatment and intervention options that are available to treat these substance use disorders. So people use substances for many different reasons. They can include medicinal purposes, religious or spiritual reasons. It can be for a person's own personal enjoyment or to cope with stress, trauma, and even pain. Substance use is really different for every single person, and it can be viewed on a spectrum with various degrees of or stages of benefits and harm. So at one end, you have abstinence or non-use. And then the other end of the spectrum, you have addiction or substance use disorder or dependence. And in the middle, you have varying degrees of use that can be beneficial, but that it can also be quite risky. So when we talk about beneficial use, it's actually you're using a substance and it's having a positive effect. So for example, if you're just had surgery and you're prescribed an opioid to help control the pain, well, you're taking that medication as prescribed and it's actually having a positive impact. Most people, though, will use in that or in the lower risk category where you're using a substance, but it really has a minimal impact on a person, on their family, or on their environment. For example, you drink, most people will drink alcohol and will limit themselves to the low-risk alcohol drinking guidelines. Some people do end up in the higher risk use category where there's a harmful and negative impact on a person or their environment. So it's using illegal substances, drinking and driving. So there is a danger, there is a negative impact going on. And then we move to addiction or substance use disorder, as it's called now, or dependence, where it's a compulsive and continuous use despite all the negative impacts that it has on a person. So a person wants to stop using alcohol and drinking alcohol, but they just can't, despite all the negative things that are going on in their lives. So before we get into, the meat of the presentation, which is about benzodiazepines and stimulants, I just want to take a little bit of time to talk about prescription drugs in general, because prescription drugs, are there to be helpful and to help us to treat diseases and infections. And when they're taken correctly, they do help and make you feel better. However, many of these prescription drugs are being used incorrectly and can have dangerous consequences. So ways that people are taking them incorrectly is when you're taking medication that's not prescribed for you. So you're taking somebody else's, or you're taking them to experience other feelings than what they're actually prescribed for. So some people will take them to get a feeling of euphoria. And it's not all prescription drugs that do this, but certain prescription drugs are used for this purpose, especially opioids, which are usually prescribed for pain, benzodiazepines that are often prescribed for a short period of time to help deal with, acute anxiety or sleep disorders, and stimulants, which are usually prescribed for disorders such as attention deficit and hyperactivity disorder. So as I mentioned, when you're using these medications improperly, you're misusing them, then it can have serious health effects. It can lead to substance use disorders, overdoses, and even death. So these risks increase if the medications are used in higher doses than they're prescribed, if they're used in a different way or for other reasons. And in a different way would be, if they're prescribed orally and a person is snorting them or injecting them, then you're increasing the risk of harm. And if they're mixed with other substances, that can also lead to harmful effects. So how can you recognize if something's going on with a prescribed medication? Well, there are red flags or warning signs. If you notice that a person is taking a higher dose than prescribed, if they're using the drug in another way than it is prescribed, so it's prescribed orally and they're snorting it or they're injecting it, if they're using the drug for purposes other than it was prescribed for, if they're mixing it with other substances, if they're borrowing prescription medications from other people. So if they have a container of medication, but it's not in their name, well, that's a warning sign. If they have a prescription and they run out often. So if they talk about losing their prescription, if they are requesting renewals much faster than they should, so they're running out of the drug sooner than expected. If people are going to the emergency room or to a walk-in clinic for the renewals, and so we're noticing multiple prescribers, it's not always the same person prescribing. That's also a warning sign. Often also people, once they are in that pattern, they'll start going to different pharmacies as well. So that in the hopes that, they can hide the fact that they're getting prescriptions from many different sources. And of course, if they're missing medical appointments, that's also a warning sign. So it's just to keep these things in mind as we're talking about benzodiazepines and prescription stimulants, which are usually prescribed to do, you know, positive things for short periods of time. So let's talk about benzodiazepines. So benzos, as they're also known, are depressants of the central nervous system. So they're sedatives. And they were developed in the 1950s by a company named Roche in order to become a substitute for barbiturates. And so an example of a barbiturate is something called phenobarbital, for example. And those substances are not really used all that much anymore, but benzodiazepines have really flourished since then. And they've been widely available since the 1960s. And in terms of benzodiazepines, some of the names that come back are Ativan, Valium, Xanax, Rivotril. And it's in 1963 that Valium was put on the market. And it really had a huge effect. 10 years later, there were about 87 million prescriptions worldwide. And it is, you know, benzodiazepines as a whole are the most widely prescribed psychoactive substance in the world. And so why are they so important in our society? What is it about them that makes them so valuable? Why do people want to take these? So as you know, benzodiazepines depress the central nervous system, and they have an effect on the neurotransmitters in the brain. There are neurotransmitters that activate the nervous system, and there are neurotransmitters that actually calm things down. And so benzos have an effect on the neurotransmitter that's called GABA. GABA is a primary inhibitory neurotransmitter, and it acts as a soothing substance. It's like the brakes, you know, of a car, but it's the brakes of the central nervous system. So that when your nervous system is going, you know, really fast and it's very pumped up, well, the GABA neurotransmitters are there to calm things down. And benzos actually increase the activity of those GABA neurotransmitters. And so it causes really a decrease in energy, a decrease, it soothes and puts on the brakes. Now, benzodiazepines have a lot of effects. And so they have, they have a hypnotic effect, which means that they cause drowsiness. They also have anxiolytic properties, which means that they reduce anxiety. They have what we call amnesic properties as well, which will affect memory. They have anticonvulsant properties so that they decrease the likelihood of seizures or convulsions. And so these are medications that are also used for seizure disorders. And they are also, they also have relaxant properties on the muscles. So why are they prescribed? Well, exactly because of all those properties that they have. They're used to relieve stress and anxiety. But it's important to know that benzos are not a first line indication. And if they are to help with stress and anxiety, it's usually for a very short period of time. They're also helpful to treat acute insomnia, to reduce muscle tension during sport injuries, to treat seizure disorders, and to treat withdrawal from alcohol or GHB. And often we say that benzodiazepines are like alcohol in a pill. Their effects really resemble that of alcohol. So there are many, many different types of benzodiazepines, and this is just a short list, but there are many others. And the ones that do come back on a regular basis, we know that Xanax is a huge, is very popular in the illicit market. There's Valium, Ativan, Rivotril are the ones that we see the most. It's important to know as well that not all benzodiazepines are the same. Some are very short acting, some are longer acting, some act very quickly and don't last very long, like Xanax, and some take a little longer time for a person to feel their effects, but they last much longer. Something like Valium is a longer acting benzo. And so benzos are very valuable on the illicit market. And so they're known as downers and benzos, bennies, mother's little helper. Some other street names are valleys, roofies, jellies, tranks. And there's so many others, but those are the ones that we hear most often. And they're used for so many different reasons. You know, for some, it's just to try to, because people are curious about it. Some like to take them because it reduces their inhibitions and helps with their self-confidence and to manage social situations. Others take them for sleep to help decrease the effects of other substances that they've used, especially in terms of stimulants. So say that they like to take benzos to come down or to come off of more stimulating substances. Some take them to deal with the effects of trauma or to reduce withdrawal symptoms or to feel euphoria. So there's so many different reasons that are really different for everyone. So how are they used? Well, usually they're used orally in tablet form. But the tablets can be crushed and dissolved in water before they are injected. So often they're snorted as well, but that's in terms of misuse. They're also available in liquid form for oral intake. They're available sublingually to put under the tongue. And they're also available in injectable liquid form, but that's really more in the hospital setting. And just like any other prescription medication, it's important to use these medications safely. It's important to follow the physician's instructions, to never increase the dose yourself. And these are the types of things that we counsel patients on when we give a prescription. It's important that if these medications are being prescribed to help with this, you know, with insomnia, this is not something that is supposed to be taken on a chronic way. We usually counsel people that if they've been able to sleep for 2 or 3 consecutive nights with the medication, well, why don't you cut the medication in half and see if you're able to sleep with that, or try to sleep without the medication after that for a few days and see how it goes. So it's really important not to take this in a chronic way. And therefore, it's important to review those the needs regularly with a physician, to have frequent follow-ups, and that if the person takes this on a regular basis every day for a few weeks in a row, it's important not to stop it without medical advice or support, because these medications cannot be stopped abruptly if you've been taking them for a longer period of time. And we'll get into that in a little while. So every prescription medication has side effects. And if, you know, it's the same thing with benzodiazepines. When you take them, you can expect to have some side effects, such as a little bit of drowsiness. You may be a little confused when you start taking the medication, or a little dizzy. Some people complain of blurred vision, of constipation, of dry mouth. And of course, because it's a depressant of the central nervous system, of course, you may get some symptoms of depression as well. When people take a little too much, or if the dose is too high, then it can lead to some intoxication. And it does resemble quite a bit intoxication that is caused by alcohol. So you'll be less attentive. You may display some inappropriate behaviors, tend to get disinhibited. So, you know, some of the behaviors may be really inappropriate in the setting that you're in. A lot of people tend to get more labile in terms of their emotions. So at one point they'll laugh, they'll cry, go from one to the other. The judgment is usually impaired. They'll have what we call dysarthria. So it's having difficulty with the pronunciation of words. It gets a little garbled, can have memory problems, and an unsteady gait, which makes people more liable to falls as well. So benzodiazepines are really there for, you know, for a to be taken in a short period of time. When you start taking them more chronically in a longer period of time, well, there's a lot more harms and risks that come with chronic use. Yes, you know, benzodiazepines can help with anxiety and depressive symptoms in the acute, you know, for a short period of time. But if you're taking them on a longer period of time in a more chronic way, it actually makes things worse and can actually make the anxiety and the depressive symptoms worse. We know that it also can cause some cognitive disorders, especially in terms of memory, and that there is an increased risk of premature death, especially in the elderly. You can imagine that a person, an elderly person who is already having a little muscle weakness, that with arthritis, may be more prone to falls. If they're taking benzodiazepines, but the risk of falls is increased. They may hurt themselves very badly, but they could have some more serious accidents that can lead to death. So these are not the only associated risks with taking benzodiazepines in a more regular and chronic way. Of course, we know that, you know, these substances can lead to overdose. You can develop tolerance, and tolerance is when a person is taking a medication a certain way, but at a certain point, it stops working. And so you have to double the dose to get the same effect. It can also lead to withdrawal symptoms if a person stops taking the medication abruptly after taking it on a regular basis. It can also cause more aggressive behaviors. It can lead to substance use disorders or more risky behaviors like having unprotected sex, which can then lead to sexually transmitted bloodborne infections, then more accidents. It can lead also to injection-related harms, which can lead to coma and even death. So there are a lot of risks. These are not medications that, you know, it's not because a medication is a prescription drug that it isn't without risk. And especially these medications can be quite risky. So as I mentioned before, with benzodiazepines, there is a risk of overdose, but it's usually not when it's just with that one medication. So the risk is very low when it's just the drug taken by itself. The risk increases when it's mixed with other substances, and especially substances that have the same effect. So with other sedatives like alcohol, like opioids, and GHB. And so what does it look like to have a benzodiazepine overdose? So often people will be very drowsy. They may be confused, disoriented. They'll have weakness and unsteady gait. They may have a speech impairment, so having difficulty with the pronunciation of the words. They'll have memory loss, a slow heart rate. They may have breathing difficulties and lose consciousness. So if you think about it, a lot of these signs also resemble the signs of overdose for opioids. So it can be really difficult to tell if you weren't with a person, you don't know what they've taken, whether it's a benzodiazepine overdose or an opioid overdose, or it could even be a mixture of the two. So what do you do? The most important thing is to call 911 right away. And if an opioid overdose is suspected, administer naloxone. And because these overdoses are, you know, can look a lot alike, often, you know, it's important to always have naloxone on you just in case a person presents with these types of symptoms. If you give naloxone to a person who took benzos, it won't do anything. It won't harm them either. But if they've taken opioids as well, it will help, and you may be saving a person's life. Now, if the person is not breathing, it's important to perform CPR, so cardiopulmonary resuscitation. If the person is breathing, then you place them in the recovery position on their side and you wait for first responders to arrive. Now, in order to avoid overdoses, especially in young children, which does happen quite a bit. It's important to store the medication in a safe place, out of reach of children and teenagers. You know, benzodiazepines look like candy. They're small little tablets of all types of different colors. And so they can look really interesting and to children if they were to come across these. So it's very important to put those in a safe place. And with teenagers who are very curious and impulsive and are looking for new sensations as well, you know, it's very tempting for them to try and take these. And so to avoid more harm, it's important to have safe storage. When a lot of people will tell me, well, I took a few and now I've got them, you know, they're stored in a safe place. Nobody will find them, but I'm keeping there just in case I may need them again. If you're not using the medications, we always tell people just return the unused medications back to the pharmacy. That's the safest thing to do. And if at some point you need more, you know, we usually tell them just come back and see me and we'll talk about it again and we'll see if that's still the best medication for you. A lot of people also share these medications with friends or family members who may be having, you know, troubles with stress or insomnia, but it's important not to share these medications with others because the medication was prescribed with the specific person in mind, taking into account the medications that they're already on, their medical issues, their mental health issues. So we're really looking at the whole person to try to find the best medication. So it's really important not to share these medications, which have a lot of risks and harms, with others. So this is part of all the counseling that we do when we prescribe these medications. Now, what happens during pregnancy if a person who's pregnant takes benzodiazepines? Well, we know that there's an increased risk of premature birth and of having a cesarean section instead of a vaginal delivery. We also know that women who take benzos during pregnancy are at a higher risk of having a low birth weight baby and having a baby, and that the fetus is underweight during the pregnancy. It's also important to know that if a pregnant woman is taking benzodiazepines regularly just before childbirth, well, the medication will have an effect on the baby when it's born. It'll be more drowsy and it'll have withdrawal symptoms. And when we're talking about withdrawal symptoms in the baby, they may be more agitated and they have feeding problems, which can then lead to even a lower, you know, losing weight, which is really a big problem for newborn babies. What do we do about breastfeeding? Well, it's also important to know that benzodiazepines can be passed to the baby through the breast milk. So the baby will have more drowsiness if the mom is taking benzodiazepines. And, you know, it may seem like the best thing to do is just to stop the benzodiazepines. However, it's really recommended that when a young mother is taking benzos and is breastfeeding or is pregnant, the most important thing is to talk to their physician about the risks and benefits of taking the medication, because stopping it abruptly can be actually quite dangerous as well. So it's important to make that decision with the whole medical team. So I just wanted to have one slide to talk about, you know, the principles of tolerance and withdrawal and substance use disorder. A lot of people think that when you increase the dose, you know, you have tolerance or you have physical dependence, it means that you're addicted. And there's a fine line between all of these that I just want to spend a little bit of time about this. So tolerance is when you have to increase the dose to achieve the same effect. So if you were taking one Ativan before bed to sleep, and then all of a sudden it's not effective anymore, and so you have to double the dose to be able to fall asleep. So that's tolerance. Now, when you have tolerance, It's normal to develop tolerance with certain medications. We know this happens with opioids, it happens with benzodiazepines, for example. Now, it doesn't mean that you have an addiction. It, you know, all by itself, it's just tolerance. It's a physiological effect of the medication, but it can be a red flag or a warning sign that you need to be careful with these medications, if that's the only thing that's there. Physical dependence is the appearance of withdrawal symptoms when you stop the medication. So certain medications like benzodiazepines, like opioids, if you take them regularly, so every day for 2 to 3 weeks, you will get withdrawal symptoms when you stop. It doesn't mean that you have an addiction, but your body's developed a dependence to this, and so you will go through withdrawal symptoms. And it does so on its own, just like that. It doesn't mean you have an addiction, but it can be a warning sign to be careful with these medications. And a substance use disorder is when there's maladaptive behaviors related to the use, where there's compulsive and continuous use despite the negative impacts on the person. So there's 11 different criteria for substance use disorders. And it's important to know that tolerance, physical dependence are criteria to diagnose a substance use disorder, but you need 2 to 3 as a minimum to say that there is a substance use disorder. So if you just have tolerance or you just have physical dependence, it doesn't mean that you have an addiction or a dependence to a substance, but they are warning signs. And it's not everybody who takes benzodiazepines who is going to develop a benzo use disorder, but there are certain risk factors that are associated with the drug itself, with the person, and with the environment. So factors that increase the risk of developing a substance use disorder with benzodiazepines is, you know, especially if a person is taking short acting medications. So the medications like Xanax, which acts very quickly but doesn't last very long, is more likely to cause a substance use disorder. If a person is taking higher doses regularly over a chronic period of time, then of course this is going to increase the risk of developing a benzo use disorder. Now, the risk factors associated with a person, individual, of course, if a person already has a substance use disorder with another substance, well, the risk is higher of developing a substance use disorder with benzodiazepines. And we know that people who suffer from depression, anxiety, insomnia, or chronic pain are also at a higher risk of developing a substance use disorder if they take benzodiazepines. So let's talk about withdrawal now. So like I mentioned before, benzodiazepines kind of have the same effect as alcohol. So it's similar, the withdrawal is similar to alcohol withdrawal, but it lasts a lot longer. And the withdrawal from benzodiazepines can be pretty dangerous and can cause severe complications like delirium and convulsions. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a short time. So the risk factors associated with complications are, you know, especially these happen with elderly patients, with people who have medical or psychiatric illnesses, for people who take large amounts of these medications over a long period of time. And so what does it look like? Well, like I mentioned, it looks a lot like alcohol withdrawal. So there'll be an increased heart rate, increased blood pressure. People will be really anxious and tired. They'll have headaches and stomach aches, nausea, vomiting. They'll have sweats and tremors. If the withdrawal is not taken care of properly, then it can lead to complications. Some people can be disoriented, more agitated. They may have hallucinations, may have paranoia, delirium, convulsions as well that can lead to coma and even death. So the complications can be quite dangerous. So it's important that if a person wants to stop taking benzos, that it's done carefully and it cannot be stopped, you know, abruptly. So there are two phases to withdrawal, to the withdrawal syndrome. There's the acute phase and the more prolonged phase. And the acute phase, which usually starts as soon as a person stops taking the medication and lasts for a week or two. So people will have the anxiety, the insomnia, the nightmares. And that's at that period, if there are going to be complications, it's usually during the acute withdrawal phase. Once you've gone through that, then the withdrawal can last weeks to months, but the symptoms are, you know, decrease with time, and people usually complain more of anxiety, of insomnia, of having nightmares and muscle spasms. So it's really during the acute phase that is the most dangerous. It's also important to take into account the medical comorbidities. So if a person is going to have surgery or has a medical illness that is not stable, it's probably not the best time then to start withdrawing from a benzodiazepine, because it can actually destabilize the medical illness, especially when we're talking about diabetes or heart disease, with thyroid issues as well, and even arthritis. So it's really important to take into account the other medical illnesses that are going on with a person. And it's the same thing with psychiatric comorbidities. We know that there's a high prevalence of mental health disorders for people who also take benzodiazepines. And it's important to know as well that patients who have an anxiety disorder, so whether it's a panic disorder or a generalized anxiety disorder, that people with the panic disorder are more likely to find the withdrawal period difficult than those that have a generalized anxiety disorder. And support. And so for this particular population, it's important to have a very slow taper and to incorporate cognitive behavioral therapy in the treatment. And if those components are incorporated, the withdrawal usually ends and there's no exacerbation of the symptoms. So it's important to do it slowly but surely and to have other psychosocial supports in place. So how do you do benzodiazepine withdrawal? So there are basic principles that need to be taken into account. So like I mentioned before many times, it's important not to stop the medication abruptly. It has to be done very, very slowly. It's a slow taper. That's why usually we don't hospitalize people for, it's rare that we're going to hospitalize people for a benzodiazepine detox. It has to be done over a period of usually months and even years. And so it's over a long period of time. Usually what we're seeing is that people take a lot of Xanax. So we tend to change the medication from Xanax to a longer acting medication like Valium. And we'll do the taper over, you know, very gradually. So decreasing by 10% every 1 to 2 weeks, sometimes it's every 2 to 4 weeks. The important thing is to really individualize the taper for the person, because everybody is different. So for example, if a person is taking 4 tablets of Valium, then we may go to 3 3/4 to 2 for 2 weeks and see how it goes. And if it's going well and the person is tolerating that well, then we'll go to 3 1/2 for another 2 weeks, reevaluate. And then if it goes well, we'll go to 3 3/4 tablets. And if at that point with that small decrease of a quarter, then there's a lot of side effects even after 2 weeks, well then we just keep it that way. And we will just plateau for a few more weeks, maybe a few months, to give the body time to to stabilize before we continue with the taper. It's important to allow those plateaus. It's important to avoid, you know, increasing back up the dose. You want to avoid that. You don't want to do the yo-yo. So it's really important to just do the taper slowly but surely, but just to keep going. And like I mentioned, it can take years for some people. Of course, you know, people are going to have some increase in their anxiety. And so there are medications that we can add to this to help people be a little more comfortable. And so some of the medications we may prescribe are antidepressants that can really help to decrease the anxiety and to stabilize it. Other times people really complain of the sweats, of the tremors, and they find that that's very difficult to deal with. And so there are medications like beta blockers that can help reduce those symptoms as well. I did mention that in certain cases we will hospitalize people. Usually it's really just for the acute phase, just, you know, because we just want to make sure that it's going to go well, or there's, you know, there are certain instances where we may want to keep an eye on how things are going to go. And so if a person has had complications in the past, if they've had seizures or they've had a delirium, we'll probably want to get started at the hospital, usually for a week or two for observation and make sure that it's going well. If they've had overdoses in the past, if they're using high doses of benzos that are not prescribed, we may want to also start doing things at the hospital. And with pregnant women who are taking very high doses, if there is an indication to taper from these benzos during pregnancy, then we would do it in the hospital as well. But usually it's not for the full period of time. It's really for a short time to observe and see if we're going about it the right way so that it can be continued as an outpatient. So it's important to also have other therapeutic options. I mentioned the use of antidepressants and beta blockers to help with the symptoms. I've also talked about psychosocial interventions like cognitive behavioral therapy that is also very helpful for people in terms of learning how to cope with their anxious symptoms. There's motivational counseling. There's also the importance of incorporating traditional healing or other alternative therapies such as acupuncture, which is also shown to be beneficial to help with anxiety. Of course, relaxation and meditation techniques, and if there are self-help groups that can also be helpful for certain people. And before I end, of course, you know, we're talking about addiction and substance use disorders, and part of the treatment modalities is to really make sure that harm reduction is part of the treatment. So it's important to screen for sexually transmitted bloodborne infections, to vaccinate, to offer PrEP for those who are at a higher risk or have risky behaviors. It's important to do some counseling about the importance of not using other substances if they're going to take benzodiazepines, to counsel about avoiding the mixing of different benzos. A lot of people take Xanax and Rivotril and Ativan and Valium and take a whole bunch of things. That can be dangerous. So it's important to avoid that. We'll do some counseling about needle exchange programs. Again, reiterating the fact that it's important to not stop taking the benzos abruptly and to ask for help if they're ready to take this on, to avoid using alone in case of an overdose, and to always have somebody with them, to have a naloxone kit, and to avoid, of course, driving while they're intoxicated. So that's about it for now in terms of benzodiazepines. I don't know if there are any questions that people may have before we go on to prescription stimulants.
Thank you, Dr. Martin, for this very interesting part on benzodiazepines. So we'll let a few seconds for participants to maybe reflect on a question, type it in the Q&A, or you can raise your hand also at the bottom of your screen if you'd like to ask your question verbally. Maybe while you're typing or reflecting on that, we did have a question in our French webinar on what can we do if we know we have a person who lives with addiction and that has a prescription of 200 tablets a week with a renewal for a year or so. What would you do?
So, of course, that is quite problematic. Yeah, I think one of the most important things when you prescribe these medications is to see the patient on a regular basis to reevaluate the need for this. You know, is it still necessary? Usually you want to prescribe these for a short period of time. Sometimes it's not possible, and that's understandable, but it's important to reevaluate this on a regular basis. And often when people have these big, if a person is going to be taking these medications for a long time, it's important to prescribe them in short installments and that they go to the pharmacy regularly, so that if the physician who's prescribing it is not seeing them regularly, at least there's a pharmacist that's also keeping an eye on them. The intervention worker can also keep an eye on them. I think everybody who's part of the team, you know, we're all there together to work together. And so it's important that if a counselor sees, is noticing something, that they can contact either the physician or the pharmacist to let them know about their observations so that it can be reevaluated quickly. But a prescription like this can be very problematic, and it happens, unfortunately.
Thank you. We do have someone who raised their hand, so we'll activate your microphone, Chastity Polson. Go ahead.
So what if you know someone that buys medication from someone that doesn't have a prescription for it? What?
Oh. Hi, good morning. I have a question. I'm on clonazepam for the past 13 years or so. It's I don't take it for anxiety. I take it for my sleep disorder, and I have sleep paralysis, and I stop breathing when I sleep, and those medications help me to sleep and to relax. And I did take a sleep apnea test, and my test was negative. So I was wondering if that's one of the reasons people take clonazepam.
Yeah, and absolutely. You know, we're talking, you know, these medications are helpful for many different ailments. And so what we're trying to say here is not that, you know, when people take these, it's bad. It's more that there are, you know, sometimes some people will take them for the wrong reasons and it can become problematic. But these medications are very helpful and are needed for certain things, like what you're describing. And so there are definitely, you know, these medications are helpful even for chronic use in certain people, but you know, it really depends. It really needs to be evaluated on an individual basis. And I think what we're trying to get to here is really just to be aware of warning signs and what to do, and if it becomes problematic, what to do about it.
Does that make sense? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And yes, we do have a question in the Q&A. So we were asking here, what if you know someone that buys medication from someone that doesn't have a prescription for it, and what to do?
Yeah, so that's very tricky. I think it's just very important to do the counseling and to let them know about the risks and to help them. I think that's where the motivational interviewing skills come in, where you try to, you can help a person try to change their behaviors or, but they have to do it. So, you know, with motivational interviewing, with the counseling, letting them know about the risks, I think that's all you can really do. At the end, they're responsible for their own actions. So you can just help them with it and giving them all the appropriate information for them to try to make better choices and to know where to go for help in case they decide to get some help.
Thank you. And there's a follow-up question on that as well in the Q&A. There's quite a few benzodiazepines on the list, but which one is the most dangerous one that needs special attention when it comes to intervention?
So the most, you know, I think all of them do, you know, if they're taken inappropriately, they're all dangerous. But one that we see, you know, a lot these days is Xanax, which is very short acting. And so it acts very quickly. So people like it because you take it and you get an effect very quickly, but it doesn't last long. So people tend to take more and more. And so people tend to get into trouble much faster with the Xanax, and it's available. I mean, it's very popular on the illicit market. So I would say that that's the most, I wouldn't say dangerous, but the one that we really need to keep an eye on. I don't know if my colleagues have anything else to say about that, but.
I think it was clear.
The only thing I would add to this is also we had a list, but there's also medication that are sold on black market that we don't know what they're made of, and they can be mixed with other substances, and those also, they're very dangerous because you're not aware of what you're taking, and there can be opioids in it. You think that you're taking something to relax, and then you get hooked on it, and then you start taking it, but then there's opioid on it, and it increases the risk of you overdosing on something that you were not even aware that you were taking. So everything that is on the black market as well is very dangerous because we don't know what it's truly made of. Mm-hmm.
And that's a good point, Joanna. And just to jump on that, more and more we're seeing that, there's Xanax out there that were on the illicit market that is being sold as Xanax, but it's not really Xanax. It's a mixture of opioids and all sorts of other things. So really what people are getting on the illicit market now, we just don't know what's in it. Yes, there's going to be pharmaceutical grade Xanax and other opioids, but there's a lot of things that are being made in, in clandestine labs where they're just mixing a whole bunch of different things together. So it's hard to know what a person is really getting anymore.
I don't know if the hands of Chastity Balsan is a new one, or if it's the last one of the last question, or if it's not, just lower the hand if we answer the question.
Other than that, if Chastity.
No, I didn't raise my hand.
Okay.
All right. You can probably click at the bottom of your screen, lower Oops. Hand, if you see it. It's all right. Okay. Just so that we don't forget you if you do have another question coming later on.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. All right, so I think that's it. I don't see any other hands or other questions in the Q&A right now. So I believe we could move forward with our part on prescription stimulants. So I'll let it to you, Lady.
Okay, thank you, Genevieve. So hello, everyone. So Joanna and I will talk about you. We're going to talk about you about prescription stimulants. So what are prescription stimulants? So they stimulate the central nervous system. So they speed up the brain and other parts of the system. So what it does, it increases the alertness, increases the energy level, increases the attention. So people are more focused and also are able to be awake longer. So they are generally prescribed to treat some medical condition such as ADHD, so attention deficit attention disorder, hyperactivity disorder, sorry, obesity, some sleep disorders. And when we talk about sleep disorders, it can be narcolepsy, which is uncontrollable need to sleep. Next slide. So here in the table, you see the main prescription of a stimulant that there are in the market. So we have the generic name, which is the compound of the medication, the commercial name, and the street name. So the name that they're given on the black market. So for example, you see the methylphenidate, you have in the same family, Ritalin, Concerta, and Bifontin. And the street name that we can heard is upper skippy vitamin R. So there are long action, short action, but what is important to tell that all of these medications have been studied and they're very, very, they're safe. Next slide. But what makes that some medication or drugs are more addictive than others? So in fact, drugs that have a risk of an addiction are those that have an effect on the brain and the behaviors and the sensation. So for example, what they do, the prescription stimulant, they have an effect on the brain. So they, for example, the dopamine, which is responsible for the pleasure, motivation, the intention, they increase the focus. Secondly, we have noradrenaline, which is responsible for the waking, for the mood, for the fight or flight mode, especially when we have a very stressful situation, which can explain that higher dose of prescription stimulant can do that. Some people can like feel threatening and be more aggressive. And finally, we have the serotonin, which is responsible for the mood, the sleep, the perception, and the body temperature. So, like I said, if the person takes the medication as prescribed, the risk of addiction is low. However, if the person takes like higher dose or take the medication, if they don't have any medical condition that they need, the risk to be misused and to have an addiction is more high. So next slide. And also what I forgot to tell is that high dose, so people that take high dose, what they will do after, they will change the structure of the brain. So the brain after will decrease natural receptor, which can affect also the person. So now we have some stats from Canada. So what we know is about 2% of people aged 15 and over living in Canada have a use disorder, have a prescription, sorry, of stimulants. So that is some data of 2019. And more than a third of them use, like they considerate the consumption it's problematically. So they taken that to have to feel high, to feel better, to be able to study, to lose weight. So that's just a few examples. And in Canada, people that is the highest amounts that they use, it's more teenager and young adults. So like you see here, people that are aged 15 to 19, there is 44.7%. And when we see the other category, 20 to 24, it's 9.1, so almost double. And another thing is that about 60% of college students that are aged to 17 to 25 who use a prescription stimulant in 2019-2020 reported that it was a problematic use, so around 12%. So we see that often, especially on competitive college and universities. So it's a big issue. Next slide. So there is certain group that are people are more likely to use that kind of drugs inappropriately. So we're talking about athletes, artists, and high school and college students. Why? Because they want to be more performant. And we see that in this category of people, the rates increase a lot in the last years. Next slide. So what are the side effects? In short term, what they will do, it will elevate the heart rate. So the heartbeat will be faster, the breathing will be faster, they will have some difficulty sleeping, decrease the appetite. So it's one of the reasons why people misuse this medication. They want to lose weight, headache and dizziness. They can have nausea, vomiting, and feeling of euphoria. And the side effects in the long-term anxiety, that's why we have to be very careful and to maybe avoid this kind of medication for people that have anxiety disorder, or they need to have like a close follow-up. Sleep disorders, people can be more aggressive, have anger, and also have some psychiatric symptoms as paranoia. So taking high dose of this kind of medication can lead to the following, for example, high blood pressure. So it's hypertension in the medical term. It can increase the risk of seizures, especially people that have epilepsy. Psychotic episode. We can have also dangerous high body temperature. I don't know if you remember, but before we said that this kind of medication acts on the serotonin, and serotonin has an effect on the body temperature. Of course, they can develop use disorder if they don't take it correctly, overdose, and increase the risk of heart attack and stroke. And talking about a heart attack, you can go to the next slide. In 2006, there were a safety Health Canada advisory. You can go to the next slide. I don't know who, okay. So, and on May 2006, there were a safety information regarding the danger of this kind of medication, that people, they can increase the risk of death, but that it's more for people that had a cardiac issue already, and it's very, very rare. So what about if we take this kind of medication with alcohol? Well, that it can be very dangerous because it can have a risk of overdose and possible death. Why? Because people are more likely to drink heavily and they don't feel the effect of the alcohol, but that doesn't mean that they cannot be intoxicated after and it can increase the alcohol poisoning. There is also possibility with other medication drug interaction, and that include medication over the counter, medication that they're taking on the street. So it's important always to double check with the pharmacist to tell to your client, to the patient, always if you take a new medication, check with the pharmacist. For example, if people take medication to relieve the flu symptoms, and they have that kind of medication, the prescription stimulant, well, there's a risk of arrhythmia, so the heartbeat is not regular, and also hypertension, so the blood pressure that is very, very high. So that can be very dangerous. And it's the same thing if people take the alcohol or benzodiazepines. And the risk then, it's more respiratory depression, so people can stop to breathe, so they can die of that. And of course, if we take with other stimulants, well, there will increase effect of like two stimulants together. So the heartbeat will be faster, the blood pressure will be higher. So, and you know the rest. So it's more dangerous too. Next slide. Oh, so it's turned from Joanna.
Yes. So yes, my name is Jonna. So I'll be continue with the rest of the presentation. So as my colleague mentioned earlier about different aspect about the usage of the stimulant, she talked about within the group it was the most used and the interaction with others, other substances. But about pregnancy, we don't have much data concerning that matter. But we think it was important to mention it. Just to make sure that whenever that it is the case that the person has close follow-up with this physician to reevaluate the need of the stimulant, also to take more to monitor the baby to make sure that the baby is safe. But the main thing that we would mention is to avoid the exposure of that project during the pregnancy if it's possible. But if it's not, it's important to take the time to talk with the physician to calculate, but to check off the benefit or the risk of take the medication or to stop taking it. Next slide. And concerning breastfeeding is the same thing. We're lacking data concerning that matter, but we do have theoretical possibility for it may cause a lower milk production. Also, it may impact the neurodevelopment it has not been studied, but the child might be monitored for agitation and slow weight gain, although unlikely. But it's important to make sure that the baby is being monitored on a regular basis. Next slide. So, earlier, my colleague talked about how the using of stimulant, which neurotransmitter it is triggered whenever we are using stimulant. So in the case of overdosing, high blood pressure is one of the symptoms. Increased heart rate, because it is going to stimulate neurotransmitter such as dopamine, noradrenaline, which is increased the alertness and the energy levels. It increases your heartbeat. It increases. It also puts you in a flight and fight mode. So imagine that the heart rate as can be increased, high temperature, sweat, agitation, and also leads to confusion, altered state of consciousness, and unfortunately to convulsion and psychosis on the long term. Next slide. So what do we do in a case of someone that we're witnessing that might be overdosing on stimulant? Well, that person might be feeling like a chest pain, because imagine that the heart rate, the blood pressure is high and the heart is beating too fast. You might feeling like you're having a heart attack. So it might be similar to heart attack, which is cause the chest pain. Difficulty of breathing because everything is stimulated in your brain. Jerky movement, extreme agitation. Also sudden and severe So the intervention to do in such case is, let's say we also went to a state of unconsciousness, is to perform cardiopulmonary pulmonary resuscitation on that person if that person is not breathing. But let's say that person is not breathing and we doubt, and if it's stimulant or opioid, but it's still important to give that person naloxone. Of course, if it's stimulant, the naloxone won't be effective. But let's say if an opioid or the stimulant was mixed with opioid, we have a doubt, it's important to at least give the naloxone to make sure that person, it can reverse the effect of the opioid in that matter. Next slide. So what to do, let's say we are in a case of a person who have a psychosis. So we mentioned that that person is in a state of alertness. That person have all these neurotransmitters being highly solicited. There's a lot that also the methamphetamine, the speed, the stimulant, what it causes is that it releases a high level of serotonin on that person's brain. So that person is serotonin, noradrenaline, dopamine. So that person is in a not just alertness, but is feeling a lot of things at the same time. Might hear voices, might not in that moment. So the approach is to just remain calm and listen to that person. Remain in call to just create that trust within that person who is in psychosis, to use that person name just to bring that person back to that to the moment, and also for that person to know that he's in a safe place, to minimize eye contact with that person because he might seeing things, he might feeling certain things, to keep your hand covered so that your hand visible so that person is not feeling threatened by you, to make sure that there's a trust or that person is safe in your presence, to move that person to a quiet area and turn down the lighting to reduce the stimulus that are around, and at a quieter area to make sure that if, let's say, that person is hearing voices, that to make sure that person is calmer, to remove dangerous object as well to protect yourself and that person, because we are not sure what that person is hearing and what state of mind that is in, just to make sure that the environment is safe, to avoid asking questions. Also to encourage that person, if it's possible, to be hydrated as well. Next slide. So talking about withdrawal and come down, what we call it, crash. Whenever that someone is using stimulant, all this, all the neurotransmitter that were released in that person's brain, it went on a high level. So how that person is feeling when all this neurotransmitter were solicited and they're super active, when that person is not on the substance anymore, it can feel a crash down, like everything is just crashing down. So that person will feel exhausted, very tired, can have sleep problems, because we mentioned that serotonin is the neurotransmitter that regulated sleep, also the mood, also the perception. So that person would, because it was stimulated too much, so now it gets tricky on the way it's being it being triggered, it's not working as well that it was, so it's just readjusting. So it may cause sleeping problems, mood problems as well, and that person will be in a huge craving to use that substances because your body is just demanding it, and also that person will we also go through generalized ashes and pain, because the body will be feel stiff, the muscle will be stiff. So when everything is relaxed and relaxed, so the body, the muscle are just being relaxed. So it's no more, how can I say it? It's not as stiff as it was. if that makes sense. Next slide. So within the withdrawal, like I said, there's a muscle tension, increased appetite, the strong urges to use, the changes of mood, because everything is just readjusting to its a proper level, decreased concentration and attention, the fatigue, the loss of energy, and suicidal thought, because under that substances, there's that neurotransmitter that was highly that was stimulated, the dopamine, which is for a pleasure, but now that is being crushed down, so you could feel down and depressed, and it can also go to suicidal thoughts. Next slide. For the treatment of that matter, we have to introduce and talk about harm reduction strategies. During the pandemic, we have encountered different situations that causes us to readjusting the treatment concerning that. So the upcoming years, we would have more prescription for stimulant for the patient that it is going to be required. But as well, as Dr. Marcel mentioned before, of course, to give that person proper training concerning how to not mix different stimulant at the same time, to take it as it was prescribed by mouth and not inject or not snort, all this, and if that's the case, to make sure that they're using the proper equipment to not use by themselves, to not exchange material, to make sure that they're in a safe place. All these things that to make sure that that person is aware of. Also therapeutic support as for social worker for housing, let's say for work or applying to for school, all these things that person needs an individual treatment. So to make sure that person needs are being met. It can also go to occupational therapy to make sure that that person is having a occupational plan for the day, and just to make sure that everything is back on track when that person is being treated. Also to treat the symptomatic treatment such as insomnia, to make sure that that person have a medication for that. For the heart, or all this, or anxiety, to make sure that we have different medication to help to treat this, the residual symptoms, and also traditional healing, because we are well aware that the traditional healing is something that is very important, that it's at the root of each indigenous community. So we are aware that it's important to refer that person to the healer of the community, or to make sure that all these different aspects are being met in the treatment. Next slide. To continue psychosocial support, primary needs, cognitive behavioral therapy, contingency management in some cases, we could use vouchers or small cash and sedative to encourage the client to not use drugs. It's a case-to-case it's individual in different cases, an approach. And there's other approach like family education, the 12-step method, and individual therapy. Next slide. Oh, now we are the last one. So we are the addiction medicine services. So you can contact us if you are going into a situation like you would need guidance, or you just need or intervention, or maybe just to give you more advice about something. You can call us. We have a physician on call every day of the week, and also me or Barbara or Dr. Marcin. You can contact us as well to give you any way we could help. We will do it. We'll be happy to do it. So, yeah.
Thank you very much, Joanna and Barbara, for that presentation. So if participants do have questions, you can type them in the Q&A or raise your hand. I'm just going to check real quick, make sure. So while maybe you're reflecting or typing again, we did have a question earlier this week as well regarding the crash. So how long would be a crash? How long can it last, a crash on over prescription stimulants?
So usually the crash, it lasts 2 to 4 days, but it depends of the chronic use, how much the person used. So for example, if the person used like just in the beginning of the month, the crash will be less strong. However, if the person used like every day or almost every day for a long period of time, maybe the crash will be longer. But usually we can say 2 to 4 days.
Thank you. Just going to give a few more seconds to make sure there aren't any questions arising from the room. It seems to be, I don't see anything so far. So, well, if it comes to your mind later on, you do have the contact information on the slide. You can also go through us at the commission, and we will make sure that we can forward your question to the SHIM or put you in contact with the team at the SHIM as well. So don't hesitate. They're very helpful and reachable, even though they're based in Montreal. So make sure you do that. So I want to thank you. Thank you all three for this really nice and interesting presentation. I want to thank everyone who attended the webinar today. So as I was mentioning earlier, we do have one question. All right, nice. So the person's asking, is benzo use on the increase in First Nation communities? Do you have any data on that addition?
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, sure. Is benzo used on the increase in First Nation communities?
So I don't have any data on that. I don't know if the commission does.
I was gonna, go ahead and say we don't have, and I have to check. So if you do want to have a follow-up on that, you can reach out to me by email or through Melissa, which sent you the webinar's link today. So definitely we could look at what we have. I don't think, from the top of my head, I don't think we have something specific on benzo. Each communities do have their own data, depending on how they collect that. So that would be an interesting question to look at, definitely. All right. So I don't see anything else for now. So I want to remind you to go and look at these tools that were developed that give accurate and useful information to reduce harm and prevent addictions on these various psychoactive substances. They're available on our website, and you can order some hard copies as well on the website. So don't hesitate. It's always free for communities. And a short appreciation survey will be sent to all participants just right after this webinar to help us improve our future webinars. So thanks again to all participants and to our presenters today, and looking forward to see you in a future event. Thank you.
Thank you.